Thanks for joining me. My name is Rick Pyves, and I'm the author of Courage, Sacrifice, and Betrayal, the story of the Victoria Rifles of Canada, 60th Battalion, and the First World War. Over the next few moments, I'd like to share with you some of the personal recollections and stories of the individual soldiers. So let's get started. Okay, first, I'm just going to take you through the agenda. First, I'd like to cover off a little bit of the background for the book. Where did the idea for Courage, Sacrifice, and Betrayal come from? What is Courage, Sacrifice, and Betrayal all about? And what is the significance of the book title? I'd also like to share with you my thoughts in terms of what I was hoping to achieve in writing Courage, Sacrifice, and Betrayal. And then we're going to look at some basic facts about Canada's military in World War I, as well as the command structure of a Canadian battalion. We'll then look at some of the sources of information that I used to write the book, which I hope you'll find as interesting as I did. And finally, we'll look at some 60th Battalion key facts. We're also going to take a look at a number of the soldiers in the 60th Battalion that fought in World War I. They're quite an eclectic group of characters, and some of them are really interesting. First, there's the war poet, Private Robert Dorman, who initially enlisted at age 14, but was honorably discharged when his mother objected to him going to war at such a young age, but he managed to re-enlist at age 15. Then there's the soldier and war artist, Lieutenant A.Y. Jackson, who later became a member of the Group of Seven, and he was quite cynical about the military, and we'll learn about some of his thoughts later in the presentation. There's also the commanding officer, Lieutenant Colonel Gascoigne. We'll see the war through the eyes of a commanding officer and all the worries that he had in trying to keep his men safe, but still doing his duty. Then there's the wounded soldier, Private Cecil Bradford, who was quite an observer of his surroundings, and he'll share with us some of the moments of war. Followed by, of course, my grandfather, Sergeant Edward Pyves, who won the Military Medal at Hill 60. We'll also look at the tragic loss of Captain the Honorable Alfred Thomas Shaughnessy. And then we'll move on to an astute observer of his surroundings and a very articulate letter writer, Private John Jack Sudbury, known to his friends as Suds, who will share with us some of his observations during the war. And finally, we'll move on to a mystery poet with the 60th Battalion. We don't know who he was, but he had a very entertaining poem, which I think you'll really enjoy. So, the writing and publishing of Courage, Sacrifice, and Betrayal took 8 years, including 5 years to research and write the first draft, which, if I do say so myself, was quite a work effort. It will be published in the spring of 2018 in both Canada by ECW Press of Toronto, and also in the UK by Hellion & Company, which is one of the largest publishers of English-language military books in the world. The book is a non-fiction account set in World War I, which chronicles the day-to-day operations of the 60th Battalion, and the lives of the 2,776 soldiers who actually had served in Belgium and France. So where did the idea for Courage, Sacrifice, and Betrayal come from? Well, it actually started about 50 years ago when my grandfather, Edward Pyves, who had served with the 60th Battalion in World War I, gave me his copy of The Official History of the Canadian Army in the First World War by Colonel G.W.L. Nicholson. And it was actually this book that stimulated my interest to learn more about the role that my grandfather had played in this world conflict, which had consumed some 15 million lives. Initially, my intention was only to write about the exploits of my grandfather and his brother Stanley, who was my great uncle, who had served in the 60th Battalion. But I soon discovered that no official history of the 60th Battalion had been written, so I decided to take a step backwards and write about the battalion, but in the context of researching all of the soldiers who had served overseas. So in the book appendix alone took some 2 years to research and contains over 30,000 facts. So what is Courage, Sacrifice, and Betrayal all about? It's a microcosm of the countless sad, heroic, and everyday experiences of Canadian frontline battalions that fought in World War I. Of the over 250 battalions that actually were raised for service overseas, only about 50 battalions actually saw frontline service. Engagements of the 60th Battalion include the Ypres Salient at Sanctuary Wood and Hill 60, and in the Somme at Zollern Graben and Regina trenches, as well as at the villages of Thallus and La Chaudière and at Vimy Ridge. It was actually the 60th Battalion which captured the villages of Vimy and Petite Vimy on day 4 of the Battle of Vimy Ridge. Most people don't realize that the Battle of Vimy Ridge went on for several days. So what is Courage, Sacrifice, and Betrayal all about? Well, it includes 86 personal recollections and letters from 20 different soldiers, including the commanding officer, Lieutenant Colonel Frederick Arthur DeLong Gascoigne. Personal recollections include the battalion's first appearance in the front lines in the Ypres Salient. You can imagine the trepidation as the soldiers went up to the front lines for the first time. It also includes a recollection of the Battle of Sanctuary Wood, where the battalion suffered over 300 casualties, as well as the experiences of a mortar officer officer caught in a German attack at Hill 60 on August 12th of 1916, when he was caught in a horrific artillery barrage and also the Battle of Vimy Ridge. So what is the significance of the book titled Courage, Sacrifice, and Betrayal? Well, first of all, we look at the 26 60th Battalion soldiers who were decorated for bravery in the field, including Sergeant Edward Pyves, with an additional 31 former 60th Battalion soldiers decorated after April 1917 when the battalion was disbanded and the soldiers were dispersed to other battalions. There were 328 soldiers who made the supreme sacrifice, with an additional 271 killed in action after April of 1917. So you can see that almost a total of 600 soldiers that had fought with the 60th Battalion were killed in action in World War I. And then finally, we address the betrayal aspect by the fact that the 60th Battalion was only one of four frontline battalions broken up after the Battle of Vimy Ridge due to political reasons. And really, this was an insult to the soldiers who had made the supreme sacrifice and to the hundreds of soldiers of the 60th Battalion who had been wounded in engagements in the field in 1916. And in 1917. So what do I hope to accomplish in writing Courage, Sacrifice, and Betrayal? Well, first I wanted to provide recognition for all the individuals who had served so courageously in the Canadian Expeditionary Force in World War I and to the men of the 60th Battalion. Secondly, I wanted to document the history of the Victoria Rifles of Canada 60th Battalion. While it was still possible to reach out to living relatives of the soldiers to obtain the soldiers' stories and personal recollections. So I'm sure you know, all of the World War I soldiers are now dead, but now also their children, their sons and their daughters, and even their grandchildren are starting to disappear. So I wanted to get those stories before they were totally lost. What were the Canadian Expeditionary Force's losses in World War I? Well, the CEF was consisted of 615,000 soldiers who served in World War I in France and Belgium. Of these, 172,000, or 28%, were wounded or gassed, and almost another 57,000 were killed in action. Over 60% of all casualties were due to enemy artillery fire. In terms of looking more specifically at the 60th Battalion, the 2,776 soldiers that served at one time or another, 1,434, or almost 52%, were wounded or gassed, and another 599 were killed in action. So let's look at the typical command structure of a Canadian battalion in World War I. At the top you have the battalion headquarters, and underneath it you have four companies, A, B, C, and D companies, each of about 200 soldiers. And under each company you had four platoons consisting of 50 men each. And the A company would be the 1st, 2nd, 3rd, and 4th platoon, and so on. In addition to the 800 soldiers in the four companies, there was also transport, signals, bombers, which were actually people who threw hand grenades mainly, machine guns, snipers, scouts, stretcher bearers, and a band. Normally, the battalion was commanded by a lieutenant colonel, and the companies were commanded by a major or a captain, and each of the platoons was normally commanded by a lieutenant with a sergeant as second in command. And I should also mention that each platoon was also broken down into four sections of roughly 12 or 13 men, which was normally commanded by a corporal or by a lance corporal. There are a number of great sources that you can use to get information on your ancestors who fought in World War I. The first is the battalion war diaries. This is one thing that I certainly use for the 60th Battalion. They're all have been digitized around the Library Archives Canada website. Another one is circumstances of death registers, which provides information on where and when a soldier died, and might also provide some additional details that may be of interest. There are also death cards on the Library and Archives Canada website that provide dates of death, sometimes long after the end of World War I. Another key source is Part 2 Daily Orders. They provide information on not only promotions and demotions, but also the movement of men in and out of the battalion. So this was critical for me in trying to put together the role of the battalion over the life of the battalion. Another good source is 60th Battalion casualty lists, which not only provides you when someone was wounded, but also the type of wound. And this can also complement information that's in the individual soldier military files that can be as many as 120 pages. The Library and Archives Canada honors and award citation cards are really helpful, especially in understanding the particular act of bravery that a soldier might have gone through to receive his medal. Local newspaper articles and honor rolls, examples of the Montreal Gazette and Toronto Star, are also very useful. Personal recollections and letters. I did this through Ancestry. I actually contacted 2,500 living relatives of the soldiers of the 60th Battalion and got over 1,400 responses and through this, I was not only able to get the 86 personal recollections and letters, but also over 200 photographs of soldiers that had been taken over 100 years ago. And also trench maps. There's a great book called Rat's Alley, which will give you the coordinates for pretty well every single trench that was named in World War I. Other sources of information include the William Notman and Sons photo collection, which is held by the McCord Museum in Montreal. They have over 700,000 photos that were taken by William Notman and Sons. And amongst these, with the assistance of the McCord Museum staff, I was able to locate 14 photos of 60th Battalion soldiers. Another good resource is local university honor rolls, which in many instances also have photos of soldiers, as well as Veteran Affairs website. The Library and Archives Canada holds court-martial documentation from World War I soldiers, and in some instances, this may provide an interesting perspective on individual soldiers. Interviews with living relatives is another good source. If you talk to sons and daughters or grandchildren of the soldiers, in many instances, they can recall stories that were told to them about the soldiers' experiences in World War I. And then finally, the official history of the Canadian Army in World War I by Colonel G.W.L. Nicholson. Here are some key facts on the 60th Battalion. The only commanding officer was Lieutenant Colonel Frederick Arthur DeLong Gascoigne, who was born in 1866 and died in 1952, and was awarded the Distinguished Service Order. Authorization was given in August of 1915 to raise a battalion in Montreal, and each company was recruited from a different local regiment. So A Company was from the Victoria Rifles of Canada, B Company from the Grenadier Guards, C Company from the Irish Canadian Rangers, and D Company from the Westmount Rifles. Here's a photo of three officers of the 60th Battalion taken at Camp Valcartier, most likely in August or September of 1915. On the left, in the background, is Medical Officer Major Harry Lauren Pavey, and in the middle you have the Commanding Officer Lieutenant Colonel Frederick Arthur DeLong Gascoigne, and on the right you have Major George Addison McHaffey. The 60th Battalion received reinforcement drafts from 33 different battalions, resulting in significant representation from Quebec, Ontario, Nova Scotia, and New Brunswick. The youngest soldier killed in action was 15-year-old Private Harry Pope from Smith Falls, Ontario. Obviously, at that age, he should not have been in an active war zone. Normally, the minimum age would have been 18 years or older. The oldest soldier killed in action was 46-year-old Private William Smith Moir, who enlisted in Windsor, Ontario. And what's interesting is the oldest surviving soldier was Sergeant John William Stalker, born in England, but buried in St. Thomas, Ontario, who died at the age of 102 in 1977. What's really amazing about this is that at the beginning of the 20th century or the early 1900s, the average age of a male at the time of death was 42. So to reach the ripe old age of 102 was really something quite spectacular. Now we're going to take a look at some of the individual soldiers' stories, which I hope you'll find as interesting as I did. The first soldier we're going to look at is Private Robert Dorman, war poet. He first enlisted in 1914 at the age of 14, but was honorably discharged in February of 1915 as underage. He wrote his mother a poem just 4 months later, which convinced her to allow him to reenlist at the age of 15, called The Argument, which I'm now going to read. The Argument. Hello, mother. What do you know? I enlisted today. I said I'd go. Yes, I mean to do my little bit. Afraid, my mum never thought of it. Oh, I know it's true, all that you say. Only 15 and going away. But age doesn't count, it's the heart within. The courage to lose, the faith to win. So come now, mother, you mustn't cry. Other boys have joined, so why not I? It won't last long, please understand. Then I'll come home to the things we planned. Remember, mum, what you have often said. The little house all painted red, a garden filled with lovely flowers, where we planned to spend such happy hours. I know how much it all means to you, dear, but really I couldn't be happy here, when I know that every mother's son is badly needed to man the guns. So cheer up, mother, don't take it so hard. You wouldn't have your son branded a coward. Come smile through your tears and think of the day when I'll return home to be with you always. Robert was wounded at the Battle of Hill 60 on August 12, 1916 and evacuated to England. He was diagnosed with disordered action of the heart and shell shock. He met and married Florence Hilda Cowley in 1917 after he recovered from his wounds, and he returned to Canada in 1919 with two daughters. He lived after being wounded for another 46 years until 1962. Next on our list of soldiers is Lieutenant A.Y. Jackson, soldier and war artist. He enlisted in June of 1915 in Montreal at the age of 31 as a private, so as a soldier he was not all that young. He was wounded on June 3, 1916 in the Battle for Mont Sorel in the hip and shoulder and evacuated to England. Although he enlisted voluntarily, he was somewhat of a cynic as it related to military authorities. Jackson wrote a letter to his cousin Jack Beck dated August of 1915. My dear Jack, this is a rainy Sunday afternoon as I am attending to a little correspondence while the rest of the tent are wrapped in slumber. We expect to leave soon for the other side. One company is going this week. Valcartier becomes too cold in September. Even now it is cold at night. I am beginning to feel like a Tommy now. Eat, drink, and sleep. Intellectual pursuits all abandoned. Of course, I am fearfully censorious at times and think a lot of things a model citizen and soldier ought not to. But there is more satisfaction at kicking from the inside than sneering from the outside. I don't admire our military system much. Still, too many trappings left over from feudal days, and the men are not taught to distinguish between what is vital and what is mere show. Musketry is a farce. They fairly shove a man through it in about 5 hours, while he spends 5 weeks sloping and presenting arms properly. The human materials are good, but amateurish all through, and that means we pay the price when we get to the front, and our officers run into the Hun boys, who have made a study of tactics from their youth up. Well, do good, Jack. Drop me a line when you find time. Ever sincerely, Alex. Fully recovered by 1917, and after an interview with Lord Beaverbrook, who was a Canadian, also known as Max Aitken, Jackson was hired as a war artist for the Canadian War Records Office and commissioned a temporary lieutenant. Jackson spent 1917 and part of 1918 sketching and painting numerous World War I scenes. He returned to Canada in 1918 and had his first exhibit as part of the Group of Seven in 1920. Jackson died in 1974 in his 92nd year, 58 years after being wounded. This is one of the paintings that A.Y. Jackson did in 1917. It's entitled House of Ypres, and it's actually owned by the Canadian War Museum, and it's in the Beaverbrook Collection of War Art. Another painting done by A.Y. Jackson in 1917 is the one you see here. It's entitled The Camel Vierstraat Road, and it is also part of the Beaverbrook Collection of War Art at the Canadian War Museum. Okay, we're now going to spend a few moments on the commanding officer, Lieutenant Colonel Frederick Arthur DeLong Gascoigne. He was born in Gosport, Hampshire, England in 1866, and he moved to Canada with his family in 1869. He served in the 3rd Regiment Victoria Rifles of Canada as a private in 1886, and by 1904 was a captain. He was a small arms expert and crack shot, and to this day there is a shooting trophy named after him. At the outbreak of World War I, he was the commanding officer of the 3rd Regiment Victoria Rifles of Canada. In 1915, Frederick was appointed Lieutenant Colonel for the 60th Battalion. He was awarded the Distinguished Service Order for Distinguished and Gallant Services and Devotion to Duty in, I believe, in 1917. He's also was mentioned in Sir Douglas Haig's dispatches of November of 1916. Interestingly, Frederick wrote 35 letters while in France and Belgium to his younger brother, consisting of over 40,000 words, and they provide some pretty good insight into the thoughts and feelings of a commanding officer of a Canadian battalion in World War I. He returned to Canada in 1918 and was appointed Secretary Treasurer of the Canadian Pacific Steamships. Gascoigne married Edith Nels after he returned from the war in 1921, and they had two daughters. He retired from the CPR in 1934 after 52 years of service, and after he retired, he was the president of the Victoria Rifles Overseas Reserve Association, and he continued to look after the welfare of his soldiers, and he died in 1952 in his 86th year. I'd now like to read you a letter from Lieutenant Colonel Gascoigne to his brother Frank, dated May 19th of 1916. Dear Frank, we arrived safely in our trenches last Monday night without any mishaps, and certainly Fritz makes it lively for us day and night, although so far we have only had half a dozen or so casualties. I would like to be able to tell you what a night in the trenches means, but it is impossible, as to realize it, one must have actual experiences. There is a continuous fire from machine guns, rifles, and rifle grenades, with some big gun shells thrown in. They keep up an incessant din, and it is no wonder that some of those who have to stay with it lose their nerve. In the early morning, one can hear the cuckoo birds, which sound exactly like the cuckoo clock we had in our old home. Other things not quite so pleasant are trench rats, which not only infest the trenches but overrun the place. Anyway, they are ugly-looking, mangy brutes, and with no fear of man. Some of the boys have had these rats go into their dugouts and run across their beds at night, which is not a pleasant sensation, and in fact, one officer claims he is not one bit afraid of shells, but he is frightened to death of rats, and one cannot blame him after seeing them. There is not much news, as you can understand, in a place like this. So you will have to put up with my prosy letters. Your affectionate brother, Fred. Next, going to spend a few moments in Private Cecil Bradford. He enlisted with the 60th Battalion in June of 1915, so he was one of the earlier recruits to the 60th. He suffered shell shock in May of 1916, resulting in a chance encounter. What actually happened was he was sent back on the lines for 7 days and ordered to return to his battalion, and he had a walk back, and in walking in the dark, he got lost, and all of a sudden this motorcycle pulled up, and the driver said, "Hey Canada, can I give you a lift?" He accepted the kind offer, got on the back, and then over the din of the motorcycle in the next 2 or 3 minutes and having a conversation with the driver, he realized he was actually riding with the future King of England, King Edward VIII. This was the Prince of Wales at the time. He was seriously wounded at Sanctuary Wood on June 3rd of 1916 when a gas shell exploded in close proximity to his face, and he returned to Canada working as a graphic designer for Imperial Tobacco after the war. In 1920, Cecil married Elsie Wilcox and they had 2 daughters, Audrey and Dorothy. Due to wartime injuries, he was hospitalized in 1932 and spent the next 5 years in hospital and actually had lost a lung due to his gas poisoning while he was on the front lines. He became first secretary of the Canadian Legion Victoria Rifles Branch No. 60 and president of Lake St. Louis Branch No. 85. He died in 1982 in his 88th year, some 66 years after being wounded. Here you can see a picture of Sanctuary Wood 100 years after the engagement of the 49th, 52nd, and 60th Battalions on June 3rd, 1916 to retake Sanctuary Wood. The 60th Battalion suffered 168 casualties, including 21 killed in action. And I'd just like to thank Roger Lent for the photo. Now I'm going to spend a few moments talking about my grandfather, Sergeant Edward Lewis Pyves. He enlisted with the 60th Battalion in June of 1915 and was wounded on August 12, 1916, at Hill 60 in the arm, hand, and leg by a grenade. Although wounded, he took over command of the platoon when his commanding officer was killed by shell fire, and in October of 1916, he was awarded the Military Medal for bravery in the field at the Battle of Hill 60, back in August. Edward was evacuated to a hospital in England and discharged in November of 1916, having fully recovered from his wounds. He was offered an officer's commission by his commanding officer, Captain Ivan Ralston, but elected to remain in England, working in a hospital as a masseur and ultimately as an X-ray technician. At the time in England, there was a significant shortage of manpower in the hospitals, and even some of the patients had to do some of the duties. He married in England in December of 1917 to Laura Hilder and returned to Canada in 1919. Laura and Edward had 2 sons, Edward and Ronald. Ronald, which was my dad. He worked for over 35 years as an X-ray technician at the Veterans Hospital in Montreal, and he died in 1972 in his 83rd year. Now I'm going to spend a few moments talking about the tragic loss of the captain, the Honorable Alfred Thomas Shaughnessy. Alfred enlisted in the 60th Battalion in September of 1915. He was the commanding officer of A Company. He was married to Sarah Polk and they had 2 sons. Sarah actually was the great niece of the 11th President of the United States, James Polk. And Sarah was in London in 1916 expecting the birth of their 3rd son. And they had exchanged many love letters while separated. And these were really quite interesting letters that I'm sure you'll enjoy hearing a few of them in a moment. We're now going to take a look at 3 letters that were exchanged between Alfred and Sarah. The first one is dated February 26, 1916.
"My darling, I received your last 2 letters, written in England, but nothing yet from France. It's been hard not knowing where you are, but I suppose no news is good news. I've wondered so often, darling, if you are suffering from the cold. Is there anything I can send you for your comfort? I'm feeling very well, and I want you to know I shall never regret having come over for those precious months we had together, which meant so much to me and my unborn child. Do write often as you can. I miss you, but I am being very brave and passing time as best I can. Know how I love and cherish you and long to have you back again. Your very own Sarah."
Just 7 days later, Alfred responded to Sarah's letter of February 26. My darling, your husband has been only 75 yards from the Germans in the thick of the bullets and shells for 3 days. We came out last night dog-tired but really glad to have been in the real thing. Of course the shells were dropping all around and the bullets were singing by at intervals, but the whole thing isn't half as bad as it is painted. The company was up there for a whole night and not one man was hit. Naturally this can't go on forever. I am bound to have some casualties. Each man has about 100-to-1 chance in his favor. We go in again tomorrow night. Our dugout is small and below ground, but we have a nice fire going in it all day and night, and we are fed splendidly. It is really a most interesting life. Just 3 days later, Sarah responded,
My own darling, I was so glad to hear you were out of the trenches. How quickly you went to them. I hope it will never be a regular thing just now. To think of you actually in the midst of battles seems too strange. Well, here I am, settled into our new home, right next door to Claridge's. I'm still presentable, but I'm beginning to feel like a ton of bricks. I received 2 satisfactory letters from Woodstock about the dear children. It makes me very happy to know they are all right. Darling, don't go looking out for German souvenirs, but if you happen to come upon some, it would be interesting to have them later. I hope you have written your father and mother. They will be anxious to hear from you. Good night, my love. God bless you and keep you safe and bring you back to me. This is my daily prayer. All my love, Sarah.
Sadly, just 2 weeks later, Alfred was killed by a high explosive shell while standing outside his dugout in March of 1916, just 6 weeks before the birth of his third son. He is buried in Maple Copse Cemetery, close to where he fell in Belgium. Now we're going to turn to Private John Jack Sudbury, known to his friends as Suds, who was a prolific letter writer and keen observer of his surroundings, and his letters are really quite enjoyable to read. He enlisted in July of 1915 in Montreal, and he was transferred from the 60th Battalion ultimately to the 9th Brigade Machine Gun Corps, and was wounded on October 25th, 1917, at the Battle of Passchendaele. Jack was evacuated to England, eventually lost his leg due to complications of the bullet wound. He was actually operated on 6 different times. After the war, Jack remained in England and served as a schoolmaster with the London County Council for 31 years. He married Agnes Askew in 1928 and they adopted a son, Robin John Sudbury. He died in 1970 in his 76th year. I'm now going to do a reading of a letter written by Jack to his younger brother Bill on April 16, 1916, and this letter is courtesy of the Vancouver Island University, the Canadian Letters and Images Project, John P. Sudbury Collection. My dear Bill, I've just thought it is about time I sent you a line or two. Well, Bill, it's Palm Sunday, isn't it? And it finds me sitting with my back to a tree in a little wood or copse, with my feet touching the bubbling waters of a little stream, the banks of which are bespangled with the blue of a multitude of violets. It is a glorious afternoon, but all the time the distant roar and rumble of the guns, together with the continued hum of airplane after airplane passing, makes one for the time being forget the springtime and its glory, and bring to mind in its place the many experiences I have had during my last visit to the trenches. These I must leave and keep them for the time when I can tell you about them by word of mouth. May that blessed time soon come. Now must stop, so with best love, your affectionate brother, Jack. The last piece I wanted to share with you is just to provide a little levity in what is otherwise a very serious historical event, World War I. And it's a poem written by an unknown soldier in the 60th Battalion called My Dugout. It measures 6'4" and it isn't very high, and when the rain's about it, it isn't very dry. Sometimes I can sleep in it, but sometimes is most rare. The rarity of sometimes was what caused this affair. I've been doing outpost duty, a rotten sort of game, and then to dream sweet dreams of home, to that dugout back I came. Throwing back the waterproof, in other words my door, I saw stretched out before me a form upon the floor. Poor mother's son, said I to me, I'll let the beggar sleep, and I sleep on the top of him, we'll make a pretty heap. I was wakened shortly after, for my mattress moved about. Confound your eyes, be still, I said, or I will kick you out. He had the sauce to argue, so I gave him such a biff. The place was in an uproar, and less than half a jiff. I draw the waterproof upon his language. 'Twas infernal. Then right away I fainted. I had slept upon the colonel. Thanks for joining me. I hope that you enjoyed this presentation on the 60th Battalion in World War I as much as I enjoyed writing it. Thanks.